Well, good morning, Chilliwack Alliance Church. It is so good to be with you today, wherever you find yourselves. And it's Thanksgiving Sunday, and so I think we do have a lot to be grateful for. I, for one, am so grateful for our team that works so hard to not only provide us a platform, but direction and leadership and guidance into the presence of our Father. And so today, as we carry on in Thanksgiving, as we spend the day in gratitude, I hope for me and for you that our hearts are softened, that we might be drawn closer to God, that our expectations, if they need to be recalibrated, that they are, and that our joy might be cultivated. So friends, I hope you have a great day today, and we'll see you soon.
Well, as you just heard from Holly, we are thankful that you were here with us, and we are excited for our Thanksgiving service today, and I am so glad that you're able to join us. So as we worship together, wherever you are, I invite you to join in with us and give our Heavenly Father all of the praise that He deserves this morning. Let's worship.
You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
Well, hello again. I'm Holly Duke. I'm one of the pastors here at Chilliwack Alliance Church, and I just want to draw your attention to a few things that we've got going on over the course of the next couple weeks. But first of all, connection is really important to us, and so we would love to know that you're out there. And so we've got a couple different options. One, you can go through our Chilliwack Alliance Church app on your phone. There's a connection piece that you can follow there. Or if you'd like, hop onto our website, mycac.ca. Head over to the tab at the top. It says contact us, and there's a little form that you can fill out. And one of our staff members will make sure that we'll contact you in the next week. Because again, we want to know who you are, and hopefully we can help you find a place where you can fit in here with what we're doing and with what God is doing. So we're excited about that. Next Sunday, which is October 18th, we got to let you know that there's going to be one service only. So I know we've had a few options, but next week it's one service only. It'll start at 10 a.m. both here and online. So it'll be live streamed at 10 a.m. And of course, like all of our other services, we will need you to sign up because we still have the limited seating. An Alpha Course, which is an introduction to Christianity and Journey Discipleship, their programs are starting up real soon. And if you'd like more information on that, or if you'd like to register, again, go ahead, hop on our website for that, actually, and any other events that might be coming up. Head to our website, click on events, and scroll down and find the one that you want. The information's there, and you'll be directed on how to register as well. And again, our website, our social media platforms are all the places that we're trying to keep. Oh, and our app, too, are trying to keep updated with all of the ministries and things like that are going on here. So make sure you stay current with those, and you will know exactly what we're up to these days. So moving on, I want to introduce you to my friend Chris. This is Chris Dennis. He and his wife, Sheila, have been longtime attenders here at Chilliwack Alliance, and we started a project in Peru in 2012, and Chris has been spearheading that. He's done a fantastic job, and we've got this great kingdom partner relationship. And we will be collecting an offering like we have over the last number of years that will be especially for Peru and the partnership that we're working on with there. So, Chris, can you give us a bit of an update after actually a brief summary of what the partnership looks like and an update of what's going on these days?
Well, thank you, Reverend.
You're welcome.
Our Peru project is a real privilege for this church, and it's such a blessing. What we're doing is we're training pastoral and Sunday school leadership in to go out into the rural communities of Peru, and we're partnering with an organization called IDEA, and they are doing an amazing job, and get to share some of what they're facing right now. But I'm very happy, first of all, to say that Chilliwack Alliance Church, you again have stepped up, and you have really met the challenge financially. On top of the COVID relief offering that we sent down, we were completely met budget this year, and that is all out of the building and down there where it needs to be. And so thank you, church. A few weeks ago we heard Pastor Leon mention the word, he wants to thrive, wants us to thrive. And you know what, we're not only hanging in there, we're thriving, and so is Peru. Yeah.
Good. So tell us a little bit about, so we collected a COVID relief fund, and we were able to send some down. What have been some of the things that we've been seeing through our friends Enrique and Rocio and the rest of our IDEA staff?
Well, you know, three main words come to mind when I think of this whole year. I mean, I know it's been a challenge for everybody, but in Peru, it's been a state of martial law, and it's a very poor country, too. Mm-hmm. So they've dealt with it on a whole different level than what we have in Canada. And so the three words that come to my mind are sacrifice, perseverance, and resourceful. Mm-hmm. And when I think of Rocio and Enrique, Enrique works in the pastoral training, and so does Rocio. They're a husband and wife. They actually, when they first started locking the country down, they moved from Abancay to a little town called Soho in the middle of the Andes so that they could continue to minister because their travel was banned. So they actually moved.
Yeah, that's incredible. I mean, I don't know that an opportunity like that has been afforded to us, but that would be something that they would choose is pretty incredible.
Yeah, and so they were able to basically have church every day with Soho and the four communities right around them. Okay. And a lot of the money that went down in the COVID relief went to things like blanket, practical needs. And it was their winter because it was our summer. Mm-hmm. And so they were able to hand those out directly from Chilliwack Alliance Church through IDEA to meet that need.
Yeah, that's awesome. So along with the food hampers and cleaning supplies, we've been able to send, you know, practical help as well, and some, you know, even some literature. So Chris, as we look at this project and the fact that we've been involved for quite a while and we are still committed to some more time on that, what are some stories that just encourage you to, you know, to look at this and say, wow, like, we are going in the right direction. These are right things to be able to do.
Well, I'm just so pleased that that God has connected us to such a credible organization. And like I said, those three words. But the next story I'd like to share is Cecilio. He's 65 years old. He was the head, Luis is the head of the organization, but Cecilio headed up the pastoral training. And he's 65 years old. And so when they did the lockdown, anybody over the age of 60 wasn't even allowed to leave their home, let alone they couldn't even go to the store to get food because they're at high risk. So here he is. He charged up his battery, and basically every day and all day long, he was phoning his communities that he was responsible for and basically having church over the phone where he could, and praying with the families directly. And so, you know, when I say perseverance, here's a senior fully engaged in what God has called him to do.
Yeah, that's incredible.
And then, you know, the resourceful part, two examples, the Sunday school team, they were not allowed to travel either, and they're a little bit younger, so they're a little bit more savvy with their technology, so they decided to take the Sunday school teacher curriculum, and they acted it all out on their phone, and they did it with WhatsApp and Facebook, and some of the communities don't even have that, but the ones that did, they were able to send them to the Sunday school teachers that they had trained, and they basically kept the program going on cell phones. So far, they have recently been donated a proper camera now, so they've actually upgraded, but it's pretty exciting. And then Cirillo was the audiovisual guy.
Yeah.
They were doing a weekly radio and TV ministry with a neighboring community that had a broadcast station. He wasn't able to travel, so what he did is he joined the translation team. And so now they have sped up their translation, and they're actually further along in getting the whole Bible done as a result of this. And he's still supporting IDEA with their audiovisual as well.
So the translation team have been working on finishing the Old Testament, and they're well on their way through that. And so the rest of the team are using the Bible that they're virtually creating, in a sense, to continue discipleship in these rural communities. And so these are just some of the ways that our partnership has just expanded the kingdom of God. And so, again, at the end of the service, we're going to be looking at receiving an offering towards that. Chris, is there a dollar amount that we're looking at?
Yeah, so we're working on 2021 now, and 2021. It ranges, depending on exchange rates, anywhere from $45,000 to $50,000. And we're confident that God is going to move in the hearts of our people.
And so that's for the total of the year.
That's for the whole year.
That's for the whole year.
And that's what we're trying to do starting in at Thanksgiving.
Good. Well, thanks for your time, Chris. We really appreciate it. And just so that you know, again, we are trying to update as much as possible. So check out our missions tab on our website. It is chock full of information. You can scroll down to Peru. Our other missions projects are there. But there are some really great stories of impact and what God is doing, not only just through our partnership, but just through some wonderfully committed people in Peru. So there you go.
Consider all Oh,
Okay, well now is the time in our service where we are just going to focus a little bit and commit to worshiping through giving. And this is our regular gift. It goes towards our general fund for the most part, and you can delineate that. Lots of ways that you can give online, and or if you wanted to, we're open Monday through Friday, 9 to 3 p.m., and we can collect or receive your offering in person, both electronically and just, you know, through a check or what have you. I'm really excited for this next part. One of the things I love about CAC is that we love our kids, and we've got a fantastic kids ministry program, but we love our kids and are committed to providing a place where we can walk alongside parents to provide not only a place, but also relationships that hopefully will help cultivate a knowledge and a love for Jesus, an awareness of how deeply that they're loved, they're unique, and their uniqueness and their value, and the fact that God has a plan for their little lives. And I want to introduce to you, she is so cute. This is Hazel Faven Pohl, and she was born on the darkest, longest day of the year. She was born a huge light to her mom and dad, December 21st, 2019. Her dad is Joe. He is our youth pastor, and her mom is Jen, and they are just a really great couple. I've actually known them since high school, so this is really fun now that, you know, that they're having this little girl. And what is going on today is that they're choosing to dedicate their little Hazel to the Lord. And so alongside of with us, we're committing with them as they walk through her little life, you know, in raising and being a place where we can nurture and walk alongside of her parents as they teach her, as we teach her, as we help this little life be formed under the truths of the Bible and of the gifts that she is going to be receiving as she grows older. And so to be able to commit together to do that is something that's happening today, kind of officially. A baby dedication is not something that is a saving act. That is something that over the course of time, as we walk alongside with this family, as Hazel is involved in the nursery, as she's involved with those of you that are serving in our kids ministry, our youth ministry, mentorship roles, teaching Sunday school, the preaching, the worship, everything that helps form these little lives are ways that we're choosing to walk together and to navigate through our culture and through society to help these kids make a decision for themselves to be able to follow Christ. And so alongside Joe and Jen, we are just thrilled to be able to do that. They're a family that is deeply committed to Christ. They are deeply committed to making their home and their relationships ones that will reflect, teach, and model who Jesus is, and they're committed to do that for her whole life. And so as a church family, we're Hazel's church family. She's got her parents, and together, again, we are going to choose to walk this road together. We are committing to each other to be those places and those relationships that will help nurture this young life until the point where she's able to make that decision on her own. And so we do covet your prayers. Her parents covet your prayers. And so there's a couple things here that they would like you to pray for. And so if you're willing to commit to do that, they would love it. Maybe let them know. Send us an email that we can maybe pass along to them. Let them know that you're praying for them. But a couple of the things here that they're looking for is that they really want to for Hazel to know, to come to know and love Jesus, and that she would grow to be a courageous woman of God that is filled with the love that drives out fear. They are praying that her identity would be shaped and formed by what her Creator says, not what the world says. And that for them as parents, they would see opportunities in everyday moments to teach her about Christ and to affirm her identity in Him. So, church, we've got a challenge ahead of us. We've got a lot of little lives that are here. Hazel is one of them, and we are so happy and committed that this is one way that we can come alongside of our families to grow these kids into a place where they choose Christ for themselves. So, we'll see you soon.
Well, happy Thanksgiving to you all. Sometimes we are feeling thankful, and other times we aren't feeling thankful, so we do so by faith. But whatever your situation is today, I hope that it will be a day that you reflect on God's goodness to you and that you will be a thankful person. Next Sunday, you know, we're just doing one service at 10, and the reason for that is because we have district leadership coming here, and there's going to be a formal installation for Pastor Matt as our senior pastor. And this doesn't happen very often in good churches. And so I hope that you will participate in the service next week as Matt is installed as the leader for the next phase of our church life. So that's coming up next Sunday. Okay, now if you will take your Bible, we're going to go into the book of Mark today, Mark chapter 6, and also there is a parallel passage in Luke chapter 4. So can you get a little piece of paper and put it in Luke chapter 4, because we're going to go back and forth once or twice, and it will be helpful for you. So, how many of you grew up in a small town? Anybody in the house here tonight? Yeah, okay, all right. Yeah, you can. If you're online, you can still put your hand up. It doesn't hurt you. All right. My dad's first church when he became a pastor was Milden, Saskatchewan. And so I went up to grade 3 in this town of 500 people. And then later on, many years later, as I got into pastoral work myself, Carol and I took the pastoral charge in Marwane, Alberta, just out of Lloydminster, the border city. And Marwane is 500 people. I think it's less now, but Marwane was 500 people. It's the kind of place where everybody knows everybody, you know, like your business is my business and my business is your business. And in Marwane, Carol and I lived in the parsonage, the church house, and it was on the road into town. So ours was basically the first house that you went by. The church was right next door. And if you wanted to keep something secret at the parsonage, then when you went by the window of your house, you'd always duck down so that they couldn't see you. And then you could do whatever you wanted in there. So interestingly, now, spool many years ahead, and this summer, one of our daughters and her husband moved to Eston, Saskatchewan. And here's a photo that I took when we were in Eston this summer. It's a beautiful spot, and there's about 1,100 people in Eston. And wow, what a blast from the past to be with them in this small town. Now, Canada is a big country with not very many people. And, you know, they're all concentrated in a few cities for the most part. But Canada is a country filled with small towns. And the question is, can anything great ever come out of a small town? So I did a little bit of research. And of course, I had to look up hockey. It's our national pastime, even though we can't ever seem to win the cup. But that's another issue for another day. Gordie Howe, great Gordie Howe, was from Floral, Saskatchewan. I looked up Floral, and they don't even list a population there anymore. You know, the Sutter brothers, whole bunch of them. They all came from tiny Viking Alberta. Bobby Clark came from Flin Flon, Manitoba. Bobby Orr from Parry Sound, Ontario. Haley Wickenheiser comes from Shaunavon, Saskatchewan. All small places. Or Canadians in music. Shania Twain is from Timmins, Ontario. Celine Dion is from Charlemagne, Quebec. And Charlemagne, Quebec is about 5,800 people. Joni Mitchell came from Fort McLeod, Alberta, 3,100 people in town. And tenor Ben Heppner grew up in Dawson Creek. Small towns and some big people from the small towns. You know, Jesus grew up in a small town. He grew up in the town of Nazareth. It was a hamlet in Jesus' day. They figure there was maybe 300 people in town. And he lived most of his earthly life there. He was born in Bethlehem, spent a little bit of time in Egypt, but spent most of his life in Nazareth. And it wasn't until he went into public ministry that he shifted the center of his operation to Capernaum, which was not that far away, but it was on a major thoroughfare. So in Nazareth, Jesus knew everybody, and everybody knew him. And it was here that Jesus was amazed. It's one of the two times in the records of Jesus that he was amazed. Now, Pastor Matt took us to the first time that he was amazed last weekend when he preached. It was in Luke chapter 7. It was in Capernaum. It was in his ministry center of operation. And it was it had to do with the Roman centurion who was stationed there, who was a God-fearer, who built the Jewish synagogue. And I just throw this in kind of for free. So I've been to the synagogue in the ruins of Capernaum, and you'll see on the photo that I took, the white stone is a later synagogue, still ancient. It's like from the 300s. But can you see the black basalt foundation below it? That is the foundation of the Jesus-era synagogue. The centurion built that synagogue. Anyway, his servant was dying, and he came to Jesus, and he said, "You don't even have to come to my place. Just say the word, and my servant will be healed." And we read in that passage, as Matt led us last week, that Jesus was amazed at this Roman's great faith, and this healing miracle occurred. So I have the other one where Jesus was amazed. And let's just say it's not as cozy and fuzzy as the other one. It's recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So this is an important incident in the life of Jesus. And in this wow time, because Jesus was amazed as we looked last week, and now he's amazed in this time, he was amazed in this time not at their faith, but at their lack of faith. So I ask you, have you walked with the Lord for a while? Like maybe a long while? Maybe you've been a Christian for a long time. Then I hope that you will raise your hoary head and listen to what the Lord might say to you today. This message is for you. This message is a call to fresh trust in the Master. And I'm just hoping that the Holy Spirit will speak to you and me in the next few minutes as we look at this passage. So, we're in Mark chapter 6, and let's talk about peas in a pod. So, the first couple of verses here in Mark chapter 6. So, Jesus left there after his last incident, and he went to his hometown accompanied by his disciples. And when the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. So, this incident takes place in the synagogue in Nazareth, Jesus' hometown. And it was a Jewish town. So everybody goes. It's not like today, I go to church. If I'm a Christian, I go to church if I feel like it. Of course, now you can't come if you feel like it. You have to register. But in those days, everybody would have been there. And Jesus knew these people who were sitting in the synagogue that day. I mean, over there is Uncle Shmuley, and here's Miriam Kravitz and her two kids. And then in the back is old bachelor Levi Rosenboom. And then, in the front is the Benowitzes. They live over by the town well. He knows all these people. And Jesus now has returned to Nazareth as an adult. He is now a rabbi, and he has disciples with him. He has some spiritual stature. So this was a very Jewish kind of place. This is going to be a wonderful service. Now, maybe you relate to the people in that day, on that day in the synagogue, in a Christian sort of way. Because they were very versed in the Old Testament. And in a Christian sort of way, I really relate to these people. So I accepted Jesus at my mother's knee when I was just a little kid. I grew up in the Christian and Missionary Alliance. You're tuned in to a Christian and Missionary Alliance church today. Well, I grew up in the CMA. I went to Sunday school. I went to youth group. In fact, I even went to the Alliance Bible College. I graduated from Bible College. And then I entered pastoral ministry. I'm telling you, I have heard thousands of sermons, many of them mine. I have been to conferences. I have read so many Christian books. I have been to prayer meetings galore. I figure I've been to to 600 board meetings. You know, if you're not a Christian after that, I don't know what's going to sustain you. You get the picture. I have lived close to Jesus all my life, and maybe you have too. After all this that we've experienced, what do we do with what Jesus says? In many ways, we are peas in a pod, some of us, with these people in the synagogue in Nazareth that day. So let's talk for a moment about what Jesus did and said. So we read in other places that Jesus taught in all the synagogues of the area. And attenders, and you can read that at the beginning of the first chapter of Mark, it says, the attenders to the synagogues marveled at the way he taught, because Jesus taught with authority. Now, this was not sort of the kind of leading that they had been getting. The leaders that they had had who would speak to them seemed to talk a lot, but say not very much. And Jesus came with moral and biblical authority in his teaching. It's interesting, just before our passage today that we're looking at in Mark 6, Jesus, and it doesn't say which one, but Jesus had raised the synagogue leader's 12-year-old girl from the dead. From the dead. And then he comes to Nazareth. So, believe me, there was nobody in the Galilee who disputed the miracles that Jesus was doing. The area of the Sea of Galilee is not large. So, the Sea of Galilee, which is really a big lake, it's 13 kilometers wide, and it's 21 kilometers long. And a lot of Jesus' ministry was at the top part here. Just to give you something to measure by, Harrison Lake is, at its widest, is 9 kilometers wide, okay, 13, 9, but it's 60 kilometers long, 21, 60. So it's not a big area that we're talking about here. So when he came to his hometown, after all this kind of stuff was boiling, he was invited to speak at the synagogue. I mean, Jesus right now is hometown boy, and he is hot stuff. And we know what he preached, because the Luke passage tells us what he preached. So you have Luke chapter 4 there, and then let's look at verse 14. So here's what Jesus preached on that day in that synagogue in his hometown. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. And he went to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. Jesus went to church. And he stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written. Here's what he read. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, from Isaiah, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. And the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying to them, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. Isn't this Joseph's son? They asked. And then back to Mark chapter 6. And in a shorter bit, it says what happened there. Verse 2, Mark 6, verse 2. And when the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. Where did this man get these things? They asked. What's this wisdom that has been given him, that he even does miracles? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Initially, They were filled with joy and amazement, but their joy did not last. So they agreed with what he said, and they agreed with what he did, but they weren't happy with him. So, just for a few minutes, let's ponder the question, where's your briefcase and plane ticket? And then Jesus said, after they were offended at him, only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without honor. So they looked at him and said, hey, isn't this Mary's boy? Don't we know his brothers and sisters? Like, they live in town here. And besides, he's just a tradesman. He knows how to swing a hammer. He knows how to chip some stone. But, you know, really, the thought is, you know, he's a kid. He doesn't have a briefcase. He's not an expert from far away. He's from here. And different versions of this passage says that the people in the synagogue that day were unhappy. It says they were scandalized. And I like what one version said, they fell foul of him. It just sort of, everything just turned sour as they listened to him. Jesus had been accepted all over the Galilee. But because they knew him, his severest critics were the ones who were closest to him. I mean, this happens to us. Just think, for example, about marriage. Okay? Some of you are married. Smile. You're married. After a while, you know, you're married for a long time and you get to know your spouse too well. You know, they always do the same thing. And there are other things that they cannot do. It gets kind of predictable. And you get bored. You're some guy, you know, some husband. You're bored. And you just kind of think in your moments of reverie, boy, it would be nice to have somebody different. Somebody more exciting. And little do you know, you moron, that some other man is looking at your wife and saying, what an amazing woman, if only she was mine. This has happened many times. Am I telling you anything you've not heard before? We are too close, and so we become blind to what is happening right before us. Like someone has said, if you're unhappy at home, try to find out if your spouse is married to a grouch. This happens in the local church as well. Now, understand, this has been interrupted by COVID, and it has been actually, if there's anything that's been nice that's come out of COVID, which is a stretch, it is that we have a new appreciation for fellowship. But there is a tendency in churches to look down on the local church because we're too close to it. It becomes dull. We wish, you know, you don't want to say it out loud, but you know what, our church, we just wish we had some more exciting people. You know, we have elders in our church and we know that they don't fully qualify biblically. Because we used to teach them in Sunday school. We know what they're like. How can they be an elder? Oh, if only we had, you know, some better pastors. Maybe we could have a bigger church like I've seen online. Of course, I've also thought, if we had some better parishioners. Anyway. We judge because we are too close to this little thing, the local church. I remember driving through a city one time and I saw a sign and it was advertising three things from top to bottom. And it said on the top, junkyard dog instant cash loans. In the middle, it said Burger Shack. And on the bottom, it said Victory Church. And I thought, boy, isn't that the truth? So you rank somewhere between beneath instant loans and the Burger Shack. Years ago, when TV preachers were at their full boil, and many of you remember that period of time, I was a pastor in a local church that had a huge debt. And we scrimped and saved, and we recycled. We didn't recycle toilet paper, but everything else we recycled. And our ministry kind of looked like it. And I remember I was doing pastoral visitation. And I went to visit an elderly widow woman from our church. And so we had a cup of tea, and she spent the whole time talking to me about how enamored she was with the person and the ministry of this TV preacher. She talked about this TV preacher like he was her son, and she sent him all of her money. Well, fast forward a number of years, and at the time, and I've done the research, at the time this TV preacher was pulling in $500,000 US a day from donations, $150 million a year at that time. So a few years later, fast forward, I had the chance to visit this TV preacher's base of operations down in the States. And we drove up, our host drove us through a small university campus with all the buildings and all the dormitories, high-rise dormitories, and they had a mail room there with three loading docks for three trucks to bring in all the gifts from this lady from our church here in Canada, and a church that sat 7,000 people. And by that time, this TV preacher had fallen morally. But he still today owns the whole thing personally. It was in his name. And I thought about it. Our local church struggled mightily just to keep the doors open. But it wasn't very cool. And so money flew elsewhere. So just one more thought here. And that's the thought of missing out. So look at verse 5 of our Mark passage today. So he said, only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without honor. And Jesus could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. I just think, isn't that something? Jesus is powerful. He could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith. He was amazed at their lack of faith. Faith is a gift from God. We read that in Hebrews. These people, in Jesus' estimation, all these people that he knew, they should have had much more faith. But these people decided not to believe. They shouted no to Jesus. And at this point, even miracles wouldn't convince them. And didn't this happen repeatedly in the Old Testament? We've just come through a number of weeks walking along with the Israelites through the wilderness. And they walked through dry ground as the Red Sea was parted. And not very long after that, their faith had withered up. And they were faithless. Oh, friend. You who have lived close to Jesus for a long time, this is a danger for you. Let's go over to Luke chapter 4. You've got your finger in there. Look what happened here. Luke 4, verse 24. I tell you the truth, Jesus continued. No prophet is accepted in his hometown. Now listen to this. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time. Okay? Many Jewish widows. When the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, not to the Jewish widows, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. She was not a God-fearer. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, many Jewish people with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian. Naaman was a pagan. And listen, and all the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. In other words, Jesus is saying, you know what? You know what? There are some pagan people who have more faith than you do. And they got up and drove him out of the town and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. Wow. Wow. Sometimes there is more faith from seekers than there is from the people of God. And when they heard that, instead of being pricked to repentance, they tried to silence the voice. Friend, the Lord will not force belief on you. He will give it to you if you want it. Nobody can do the Christian life to you. This must be a decision of your will to cast yourself on the Lord, to follow him as a disciple. And ultimately, Christianity is not about reasoned arguments. It is not about miracles and mighty works. It is about your decision and mine to take Jesus at his word and to place our trust in him. And these people in our passage in Mark and Luke were robbed of great things that the Lord wanted to do among them. And they didn't even know it. So, brother, sister, you who have been around the things of Jesus for a long time, think with me now. How sad if over time we are not moved by saving grace. How sad if we never weep when we worship. How terrible it would be if we forget the feeling of being lost before we know Christ. And that the scriptures are not precious to us. That we don't long to meet together in fellowship. That somehow we're fine. How terrible that if we aren't hungry to live a pure life. How sad if we don't experience deep joy in knowing Christ. And so, I hope if you have identified with the type of people that Jesus encountered that day, I'm just encouraging you to invite the Holy Spirit afresh to fill you. That you would afresh make Jesus Lord. And invite the Holy Spirit to enliven the scriptures to you like you may not have seen them for a long time. That you would open your heart to the Master afresh. And that when once again we are able to come together en masse, that our times would be marked with expectancy and joy. So as I close today, Jesus expected these people to have more faith. And he was amazed at what he found. Oh Lord, save us from the deadening familiarity with the sublime. Lord, meet us by your Holy Spirit and awaken us to what you want to do in us. One of our great Alliance leaders, A.W. Tozer, said this. Follow it. It's a paragraph, but it's good stuff. Believing is directing the heart's attention to Jesus. It is lifting the mind to behold the Lamb of God and never ceasing that beholding for the rest of our lives. At first, this may be difficult, but it becomes easier as we look steadily at his wondrous person quietly and without strain. Distractions may hinder, but once the heart is committed to him, after each brief excursion away from him, the attention will return again and rest upon him like a wandering bird coming back to its window. You can be like that. You can be like that. Step in by faith to who Jesus is, to what he says and has done. and to what He is calling you to be. Chantel's going to lead us in, I think, a really appropriate song. Lord, I need you. And let's afresh, whether you've been a Christian for a short time or a long time, and if you aren't a Christian today, that you would let the Spirit of Jesus speak to you about it. Let's sing this song together as the Holy Spirit searches our hearts.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
As I close this morning, I just want to highlight what was said earlier in our service with Holly and Chris. We have desired as a church to extend our gospel reach, certainly to touch our community, but also to be part of the action in the world. And so we have adopted four longer-term areas of missions partnership focus in the Baja, Mexico, in Iraq, among the Yazidi people, in Quebec, through Rimouski Alliance, and through Peru. And we have, through our partnership in Peru, seen consistent gospel fruit in the mountains of Peru. As the New Testament has been translated and distributed, and the Old Testament is almost done, as they have taught people to read the Bible, many of who did not know how to read, as they have planted churches and Sunday schools, for kids have traditionally been overlooked with gospel work, and we have been part of that action. And so, every Thanksgiving Sunday, we receive an offering for Peru. This is a statement of faith by us as a church. For we have been walking a financial tightrope locally through COVID. But we just feel like we're partners, we're gospel partners, and we want to do what we can. So let me encourage you to give to this Peru project, either physically at the church office, you can come in all those ways. You can give through the vase at the back of the church. You can, there's a button on the church app under missions, and you can follow that through, and it denotes the Peru project, and you can give that way, and then we will send that down and continue to partner with this group and see the Quechua of Peru come to Christ. It's cool to be part of that action. So let's pray together, and I would like to pray for you and with you as we close our time. Holy Spirit of Jesus, show us Jesus Christ the Son as we draw near to Him. I pray for each willing heart who is part of our service today. I ask, Holy Spirit, that You would search, that You would illumine, that You would give faith where faith is needed. And Lord, in our local setting, that we would decide we will never be a hindrance to Your blessing. We will receive what You have to say, and we will do it. Lord, as a congregation, some who are far online, some who are near online, some who are present physically, would You keep us spiritually fresh? You keep us expectant for what You are doing in the world and the things You want to do through us. Speak, Lord. Holy Spirit, come. We pray all these things in the name of the Master, Jesus. Amen.